Over to Dr. S. N. Gupta to introduce our chairperson and to take the CME forward.
Thank you, Dr. Chauhan. This evening we will be having a talk on hypothyroidism, both overt and subclinical, and if time permits on other related thyroid topics by none other than Dr. S. K. Mathur, who is very well known to the group because he is one of the founders of the group, and he is an extremely erudite speaker, an eminent physician, and a very thorough gentleman and a very close friend. So without further ado, I would hand over the podium to Dr. Mathur.
Thank you, Dr. Sengupta. Good evening, friends. My honor to be here in front of you all to present something about thyroid, but to carry on this group so far. So today, we're going on to talk about the mainly overview of disorders of thyroid gland. Basically, I will be focusing on the hypothyroidism. As we all know, thyroid is one of the very common or the most common disease in the endocrine disorder. They're one of the very common, like diabetes. And among thyroid, the hypothyroidism is the most common disorder. So we will like to focus on hypothyroidism. And before we come to hypothyroidism, like negative feedback mechanism and functions of thyroid hormone. As anatomy, we all know, is the gland, which is a butterfly shape, located in the center of the neck, over trachea. It has got two lobes, right in life and joined by the isthmus. Why is it important to know the anatomy? Because thyroid palpation is also very important clinical evaluation. Whenever we see a patient of thyroid, I think it's important to see a neck and assess whether the gland is enlarged or not. It will make a lot of difference while we're planning our treatment. So a palpation of gland is important. Of course, I'm not going further into the anatomy. Thyroid hormone synthesis and physiology. Iodine oxidation is mediated by thyroperoxidase enzyme. Iodine is the most important part. It is the form, inactive form of iodide, and gets converted to iodine in active form. We'll further discuss on the next diagram. TPO is activated by thyroid distributing hormone required for the production of monoiodine tyrosine and diiodine tyrosine, and they are both joined together in the form T4, T3. To know more about this, as a thyroid follicle cell has got two surfaces, basal surface, which is closer to the capillary and blood circulation, and apical surface. There is a Golgi apparatus that produces thyroglobulin, which goes into the follicle of the thyroid cell and forms colloid. Then the active, most important part of the thyroid function is the iodide, which is taken out diet, and it goes into circulation from circulation to the thyroid lumen. It is by sodium iodide supporter. It is available on the surface, helping trapping of the iodine into the gland, which gets into active form from iodide to iodine, and from iodine it goes into the lumen, where it is combined with the tyrosine, which is available in the thyroglobulin, for monoiodine tyrosine and diiodine tyrosine. Thereafter, biologically not a human being, they combine together to form tetra and triiodine tyrosine. This further gets out from the follicle, I mean lumen of the follicles, and come into cell, where it is lysozyme and cleaved back from the thyroglobulin and become free, I mean independent T4 and T3, and back into circulation. In circulation, T4, T3 are in two forms, that is total T3 and free T3, total T4 and free T4. This production of T4 is 80%, it is a more stable hormone, and it gets further converted to periphery to T3. So thyroid hormone synthesis is the one thing where we know the basics. It is important that iodine is taken diet, goes into the cell, get into T4, T3, comes out of the cell, and which is important for the basic metabolic function. There is very important negative feedback loop which is there. So thyroid hormone, which is produced from thyroid gland, goes into circulation, sends a message to the anterior pituitary and hypothalamus. Accordingly, anterior pituitary secretes thyroid stimulating hormone, which controls the secretion of T3, T4 as we go on by. And hypothalamus, this secretes thyroid releasing hormone, is also helps in stimulates the pituitary to secrete TSH. So this negative feedback is important because TSH is the most sensitive hormone available in circulation and easy to measure, and it gives a lot of information in the management of hypo or thyroid disorder. Functions of thyroid hormone itself, I mean, it's very important hormone. It makes the complete function, like helps in the increase in BMR, basal metabolic rate, affects protein synthesis, help with long bone growth, neural maturation, regulate protein, fat, carbon, metabolism affecting grow with a rate and cell use energy. Essential for development of different cells in body. If you say overall, thyroid hormone helps with utilization of oxygen available in the blood. It helps with the transmission of oxygen from blood to all the cells in the body. The cell metabolism or total metabolism of body depends on thyroid hormones primarily. It affects your mental faculty, physical activity, and sexual activity. Now, thyroid disorders. We have given it two only, hypo and hyperthyroidism. But there are other disorders also. There is a goiter, which can be nodular goiter, multi nodular goiter, solid nodular goiter. But we are only focusing today on hypothyroidism, which is commonly Hashimoto's thyroiditis, congenital hyperthyroidism, linked to myxedema, peritonitis, myxedema, postpartum thyroiditis, subacute thyroiditis, and sick euthyroidism. Further down, hypothyroidism is under functioning of thyroid gland. It can be subclinical or overt. Hypothyroidism is of two types, nearly two types, primary and secondary hypothyroidism. When we talk about the hypothyroidism further, primary is caused by the failure of thyroid function. The thyroid gland has not been able to produce required type of T4, T3, and secondary, inadequate availability of TSH secretions from the pituitary and TRS from the hypothyroidism. Primary hypothyroidism is most commonly caused by the chronic autoimmune thyroiditis, less common cause being radioiodine treatment and thyroidectomy. I would say further down, this is the visual slide. When you go on primary thyroidism, the autoimmune thyroiditis, a little more on autoimmune thyroiditis, it's the most common cause of hypothyroidism. The autoimmune hypothyroidism means there is an immune system alteration, the autoantibodies like anti-T2 and anti-TG form, which affects the thyroid hormone secretion. Congenital absence of thyroid gland itself, this agenesis or disharmogenesis, thyroid removal by surgery, of course, subscapular thyroidectomy or total thyroidectomy, radioablation, and particularly hyperthyroidism, when the thyroid hormone function goes down and becomes hypothyroid, destruction of thyroid tissue caused by the infertility disorder. These are sarcoidosis, amyloidosis, then impaired synthesis of thyroid hormone. Earlier, iodine deficiency was a very common cause of hypothyroidism. Nowadays, we don't see too much of iodine deficiency, particularly in the city like Delhi, where we are iodine sufficient, which is a more cause of autoimmune hypothyroidism per se than the hypothyroidism. Then, iodine deficiency, of course, congenital, we spoke about. Secondly, hypothyroidism, again, is not so common, but it is to see in Israel. This is because of reduced secretion of TRS and TSH from the hypothalamus and pituitary. Hypothalamic disorders, tumor, lymphoma, germinoma, all these disorders are not so commonly seen in our practice, but yes, it is worth mentioning that there is a secondary cause of hypothyroidism also. Transient thyroidism is also not so uncommon. Silent thyroiditis, including postpartum thyroiditis, has happened. Something known as the Sheehan syndrome, where due to sudden changes in the immune system only, because immune system, there is a transient hypothyroidism. Initially, there may be hyperthyroidism. It goes with euthyroid or hypothyroidism. It is generally self-limiting, gets controlled. It doesn't stay for long. Whereas subacute thyroiditis is a painless thyroiditis. It is due to virus thyroiditis. It is an infective kind of disorder where there is a destruction of thyroid gland, it goes into hypothyroidism. Again, this is a initially maybe hyperthyroidism, but settled down to hypothyroidism. Normally they are self-limiting, they get cured by themselves, but 5 to 10% of subacute thyroiditis go into permanent hypothyroidism also. Withdrawal of thyroxine treatment is individual with the intact those who are hypothyroid taking treatment and then stop, then again go to hypothyroidism. Treatment of subtotal thyroidectomy in Graves' disease. When the gland is removed partially, they can be hypothyroidism temporarily. Now, after having known basics about so-called hypothyroidism, we go into the evaluation of the patient. When the patient comes to you, what are the symptoms? So these are the common symptoms of hypothyroidism, which you all know. There is symptoms of tiredness, dry skin, cold sensation, hair loss, poor mental coordination, constipation, dyspnea. The symptoms are plenty. We can say any symptom of hypothyroidism can be related. But they are so vague, you cannot diagnose the patient on the symptom alone. But a high level of suspicion, when you see the patient with a symptom complex like this, you must suspect and go into detail further evaluation of the thyroid. When we do it, having suspected hypothyroidism on the symptom basis, A clinical revision is also important. In the clinical revision, we have all this examination of the patient per se. We find that there's a bradycardia, there's a cyanomegaly, there's dry skin. These are some findings. The important finding, I would say, in the clinical revision is a evaluation of palpation of thyroid gland. If there is a thyromegaly is there, it gives a lot of our input as to the diagnosis of hypothyroid. If thyromegaly is there, what is the cause of thyromegaly? We should treat it. These are the so-called hypothyroid signs. This is a prevalence study done in Kerala. This shows that there were 971 patients they evaluated. In a normal thyroid function test they do at any lab, 80% should be normal. That is the study they did. And in this, the normal thyroid is 80%, the 4% is hypothyroidism, I think 1% is hypothyroidism, subclinical hypothyroidism is 9% in this study. 2% is subclinical hyperthyroidism and another 4%. So the study reveals that there is a large chunk of the population is subclinical hypothyroidism, whom we suspect, evaluate and manage. So the subclinical hypothyroidism is a very important clinical entity which helps in the management of patient management. Now, diagnosis, algorithm for diagnosis of hypothyroidism, the most important tool in diagnosis of thyroid function test is that TSH is the most important. A thyroid stimulating hormone is a very sensitive hormone which gives the initial suspicious about the thyroid disorder. So in this TSH, when we do first, it's normal, then it's normal, we don't do anything else. If it is high, we do FT4. These days, normally we order whenever we see a patient, T3, T4, TSH. I think that's a little overdoing at the investigation. If you suspect a patient, firstly, just do a TSH. Wait and watch the report of TSH. Compare with the patient's activity, and then we go for FT4 if required. FT4, if it is low, it is hypothyroid. If FT3 is normal, it is subclinical. Now, when we diagnose subclinical hypothyroid, then many other things do. We can't treat only your TSH when you are FT4. We see further, I will come to the next slide on that. Then of course, when TSH is low, FT4 is normal, again subclinic hyperthyroidism, which is not very uncommon, but generally we don't treat, we wait and watch for that. And when it is high, of course, it is subclinical, overt hyperthyroidism. Now in this important point, we come out to management. Before we do manage, we have to go for concrete diagnosis of thyroid. So when the elevated TSH we see, confirmed by a check on T4, anti-T2 is a very important tool for diagnosis. Only FT4 TSH. If TSH is less than 10, if TSH is 5, 4 to 10, it is subclinical and we don't treat them. Anti-T2 is a very important tool to do that, and when we do anti-T2, if it is positive, it is worth treating them. TSH, I mean all this then, of course, then anti-T2, if anti-T2, TSH less than 10, anti-TPO positive, we consider treatment of anti-4. TSH less than 10, anti-TPO negative, we wait and watch, repeat, reassess the patient, symptom complex, family history, thyroid megaly, all those things together. So we have overall appreciation of patient's profile before we put on medication. Because this medication is a long-term medication. It is not overnight medication. So if when we start with thyroid patient on medication, we should be very careful to start with so that we don't regret later. And when there's a TSH more than 10, there's no doubt we can go straight away on that. And another important rider we have, when there's an elderly patient who has no symptoms, no goiter, no increased lipids, and no, I mean, pregnancy or elevated cycle, there again, you cannot ignore them. You have to just follow up them after 3 to 6 months, see that if there's a progressive increase in the TSH values, they are the cases where we can start medication. So progressive increase in TSH value over a 6 month time or 3 months time, it gives an, guidance to us to treat the patient. Now, something about subclinical hypothyroidism before we compile. This is the most important entity today in practice we see. All of us practicing thyroid, I mean, all physicians do see thyroid patients, they treat it. Why not? It's the most important, most commonly found disease. And subclinical hypothyroidism, we say, when the TSH is raised and FT4 is normal. Patient may not be symptomatic. TSH is raised from earlier cut off by 2.5, now 4 to 10, in between anyway. TSH is raised, we have to suspect a subclinical hypothyroidism, and when to manage them become possible.
There is a new 8-year guideline, Dr. Tulsi will put light on that, which has recently come in 2017, in which they talk more about pregnancy, the cutoff from 2.5 to 4 day weight. So, but they're more on the, this is huge 56-page guideline. I think I don't have stamina to read, but Tulsi will guide us. Dr. Tulsi will guide us.
Sir, you are the master.
Coming to subclinical hypothyroidism further, grade of primary hypothyroidism, in which there is an elevated thyroid stimulating hormone concentrated in the presence of normal serum free T4 and tri-LN5, whereas T3 has got low value in diagnosis. So we do it very often, I think it's a waste of money. It should not be done. Anyway, that's a different part of the story. Then this is the one gives a great suspicion. May progress to over hypothyroid approximately 2 to 5% case annually. When there is a subclinical hypothyroidism, if we don't treat, they may go into over hypothyroidism in due course of time. All patients with overt hypothyroidism subclinical hypothyroidism, TSH more than 10 should be treated. That's a guideline which we all know and we must treat. Prevalence of approximately 5 to 10% in that study which we saw, it's about 9%. But there are a lot of studies which is further to come down to see, it is ranging around approximately 10% plus minus 1. More frequent in women with increasing prevalence with their advancing age. Another observation which I have to make it, as the people go in age, more 60, 65, 70, subclinical hypothyroidism incidence are going up. Their TSH levels are higher. And to treat them is again, we will discuss that later, but it is higher in the elderly. Classified in two categories according to serum TSH level, mild increase TSH 4 to 10, constitute about 90% of subclinical, and more than 10, of course, is the treated state. Most cases of persistent subclinical are due to autoimmune thyroiditis. Again, the autoimmunity comes in a very, plays a very important role in thyroid hypothyroidism and subclinical hypothyroidism both. There is a TSH receptor account for the small portion of cases. TSH receptor which is there on the basal surface of the cell, which takes the TSH receptor in. But TSH receptor get defective. They come, there something TSH receptor antibodies also. But there, due to this, there may be a less production of T4, T3 from the gland, but that is a very rare condition. Now we come to transient elevation of TSH may occur in subacute painless thyroiditis following withdrawal of L-thyroxine during the recovery from the significant non-thyroid illness. A serious patient may become, a TSH may become high and FT4 become low. During the treatment, the various drugs, lithium, amitriptyline, increasing age is one of the criteria. It might shift working again. The corporate world, the youngsters who are sleeping late, not sleeping well, tired, exhausted, they can have raised TSH. Following vigorous exercise, mood disturbance, depression. Depression, we are not in depression, is very, very common presenting symptoms in a lot of subclinical hypothyroidism. An initial raised serum TSH FT4, the reference rate should be investigated and repeated and measured both. I mean, there's a repetition of safety. TPO are the most sensitive serological test for thyroid quality in subclinical hypothyroidism. I repeat, we do both the antibodies, TT and TPO. But TPO is the most sensitive parameter to go into that activity. Sometimes there may be normal youth patients are raised TPO. They are also highly suspicious of developing hypothyroidism or subclinical hypothyroidism due course of time. A hypoepic or an inhomogeneous thyroid echo pattern at the ultrasound may present before circulating autoantibodies and provide early evidence of thyroid activity. Thyroid ultrasound is also a modality that we do these days. But I personally feel it is not required to diagnose any of these disorders subclinical hypothyroidism, but it is one of the modalities available to us. Another, these are few kind of recommendations or guidelines. Whom do we screen for subclinical hypothyroidism? When do we screen subclinical hypothyroidism? This is the lot of guidelines are there, but in nutshell, I'm surprised by experience. Highly suspicious patients are those, particularly I take the patient having a thyroid on clinical examination, they having symptom complex in the history of hypothyroidism, they have family history of hypothyroidism, there is an autoimmune disorder in them. These are the people who should be thought of. Then pregnant lady or lady who will get pregnant also. These are the people we can suspect highly and try to do adhesion. People more than 35, people more than 65. There are various guidelines, but in that shell we should use our clinical equipment before we order a test. That is most important. There are other guidelines which are there. I don't think it's required to go into detail there. We just look into ourselves where we do, TSSS is more important, our own clinical design. Biochemical diagnosis, subclinical hypothyroidism is not a clinical diagnosis, clinical suspicious diagnosis is biochemical. It's a controversy, its most definition is arbitrary. But controversial though it is, but however, in practice we see treating subclinical hypothyroidism is beneficial to the patient at large. So we should not go into controversy and TSS is different from between studies. Again, the lab to lab, time to time, TSS may differ values. But since the cutoff is 10, we treat after 10 and before 10 we suspect, and we have other parameters to support anti-TPO and clinical profile. I think it's quite okay. Ethnicity, geographic region, gender, pregnancy status, these are the variables which can affect the TSS values. Subclinical hypothyroidism commonly classified as a mid, mild when TSS values between 4.5 or to 10, and severe when TSS is more than 10. But this is again the two classifications, cutoff is 4.5, the cutoff is 4 somewhere, cutoff is 2.5. Depending on the, again, patient profile, we can use the cutoff line from 2.5 to 4 or 10. 10, of course, is TSS. Now, subclinical hypothyroidism in diabetic setting. 10% of patients with type 1 diabetes mellitus will develop chronic thyroiditis. This is what we talked about, because type 1 diabetes is also autoimmune disorder, and this is autoimmune disorder. So there is similarity in their pathogenesis. Some patients with infertility and menstrual irregularity have underlying chronic thyroiditis in conjunction with the subclinical and clinical hypothyroidism. This is a very common patient in gynae practice. The patient comes with infertility or subfertility. Subfertility is a thing, they are not getting fertile after due exposure to them. Then we should suspect this thing. And another thing is the depression. Depression is a very vague term. When we decide who is depressed, who is not depressed, it is left to the clinical judgment of the doctor. Treatment algorithm, as we just talked about, basically TSS less than 10, antibodies, thyromegaly, clinical profile, symptom complex, we should treat. And the TSS is, 2.5, antibodies negative, 65 and above, and all these symptom complex, can't read all this properly. But there is a cutoff line of less than 10, 4.5, symptom complex, thyromegaly, autoantibody is positive, we should treat. And now we'll come on doses later and treat with the levothyroxine with the gold to serum TSS, this is more than 10. Okay. Now, something about congenital hypothyroidism, which is also very commonly seen. There's one study which says 1 in 2,650 children born, new left. There is the incidence of subclinical hypothyroidism. A world literature says 3,800 children born, out of 1 in 3,800 is subclinical congenital hypothyroidism. This literature I got it from some Unikrishna's this thing. I don't know how it's true. Dr. Tulsi will throw light
in front. 1 in 4,000, this is what they say.
3,800 is quoted seventh, and 2,650 is that. Thyroid iodine hormone deficiency at birth is the most commonly caused by the problem with the thyroid gland development, dysgenesis and dysharmogenesis. Common signs, you know, but most important, whom do we suspect of having a congenital hypothyroidism? Then this of course symptoms we see, the pediatrician can guide us, mother can guide us on these symptoms. This guide, as they sleep, less sucking reflexes, poor. These symptoms are there, tongue is big, umbilical hernia, these symptoms are there. And primary congenital hypothyroidism screening has been shown to be effective for the testing the cord blood or blood collected at the age of 24 hours. There is one, but then 2 to 5 days is a window they give. The second day to fifth day, if you collect the blood, if percentile follow up TSS test means, if the less than 10 percentile means they are suspect of congenital hypothyroidism, defect in fact is the secondary and central pituitarism, hypothyroidism and infant is released. Initial blood assay, more than 30 they have said, some rate is more than 40, but depending on this picture, we can suspect that the congenital hypothyroidism. What is important of congenital, if we diagnose in time, we can prevent them from going to mental retardation. It's the most important thing, high level of suspicion for neonate having congenital hypothyroidism. We must treat them at right time. and treatment can prevent them to get retarded, criticism, all those things. So it's a very important to assess the new neonates for the congenital hypothyroidism. This one literature we have shown it 1 to 4 days, 25 less than 39, and 2 to 4 weeks less than 10. This is from GSK, they have given some figures, I don't know where to quote and what is the authenticity of that, but these are the few figures they have. Then evaluation, another figure they give, less than 6 to 20. But in my clinical experience, a little reading, I would say suspicious is important. Suspect them, do between 2nd and 5th day of the birth. If the TSS is less than 40, we follow them more than 40, treat them. That is what. And clinical evaluation, the patient is very important. The mother is very good judge of the patient, and of course, pediatrician see them, how child is responding in the normal group. Early treatment with levothyroxine to prevent the complications, improve the IQ, on oral levothyroxine, normalize hormone level in 1 to 2 weeks. American Academic of Pediatrics recommends starting with LC4 as a dose of 10 to 15 micron, high doses. Younger the person, higher the doses. Normally is 1.67 microgram per kg per body weight in adults. It is 10 to 15 microgram per kg body weight, means higher dose to be given that. And it's very important to counsel the parents, counsel the mother. How to give the process, because this is very important, the patient to be given a right dose if you are diagnosed a congenital hypothyroidism to prevent any mental retardation. Continuous monitoring thyroxine level, lifelong hormone treatment to be given, this is the care of that. Now, let's talk about levothyroxine, which is a very important medicine, such as sustidava I would say, and how to use it is important. Levothyroxine is used of replacement is the correct standard care, empty stomach at least half an hour before food, not at the same time calcium, vitamin, iron supplement, even antacids, particularly PPI. They should not begin with them. Long half-life and nearly constant steady state circulatory level. The LT4 has a half-life of 7 days. And once you give them 7 days, they start showing the result. After 7 days, they start showing the effect. And we can't assess the overnight result of that. So this is very important, the doses. Now, how to start the doses is one. As per normal guideline, 1.67 mcg per kg body weight, but that doesn't hold good in the practice. It is not practical to calculate the weight and do it, it doesn't work. So two full dose in young, healthy individuals, that's okay. We can give that. Generally, see the elder people, we start with low dose. 25 mcg, 50 mcg. Step increase. Again, senior person 65, 75, 85, you may start with 12.5 hours because they must be having comorbidities, maybe having some cardiac complications, which can precipitate thyrotoxicosis or tachycardia in these patients, so be careful. Similar approach for those with the caudal, we come here, 15% hypothyroid patient with angina report worsening after thyroid therapy. So very careful with the cardiac patient. If you have somebody having angina, he may become worse, will start to give it. But lower dose is a hallmark, 12.5, 25 can start. Drugs which interfere with the thyroid hormone absorption, bile, acid secretion, phosphate binder, early state, iodide, iodines, iodine contrast, abedron, these are the drugs which we normally not use, but they interfere with the thyroid hormone utilization. Okay, this is also important to we have few minutes that hypothyroid and concurrent, concurrent condition like first thing you go on a diabetes. When a diabetic patient have a higher chance to have hypothyroidism, we should suspect thyroid and hypothyroidism, and so is vice versa. Hypothyroid also can be a diabetic. So treating hypothyroidism in diabetic patient should be careful, and we should be rather more. Would they evaluate them properly and treat them. Same is with the CVD, and just talk about coronary artery disease, or all the heart patients should be treated carefully with thyroid patients. Elderly patients, again we talk just now, more the age, less the dose, and should be monitored carefully. And cut-off line in the senior people's cases can be high. Normally we take 2.5, 4, 6, even when we treat the patient, if the TSS comes around 6, we should be happy. We should not try to aggressively bring down 2.5. In a senior elderly patient, the TSH acceptance is about 6 or above can be found. Hypothyroid infertility, as we said, if there is a subclinical hypothyroid, infertility patient should be evaluated for hypothyroid and treated, and good results are obtained by treating the infertility measure. Pregnancy, here is the new guideline which Dr. Sulsi will tell, ATP, American Thyroid Guidelines. They have cut off from 2.5 to 4. That's I think later they talk about. So in the pregnancy, hypothyroid is important, it should be treated. Normally says we should evaluate the patient. Those ladies who want to get pregnant, the TSH should be done before they come for first counseling. Thereafter, it can be done trimester wise. Earlier it was 2.533, now they say it is 4. Another thing, there is no, in a hypothyroid in pregnant lady is important because it prevents a lot of stillbirth, premature deliveries, so should be treated properly. Now, when we talked about it, some just a few minutes more, the prevalence subclinical is 9%, over is 4%, that we just gone by. Evaluation, TSH values, and FT4 values, and NTTPOs, these are important things which you know, we should evaluate them. FT4 doses, as we discussed, FT4 doses starting, titrating, and maintenance. We have to start with the low dose or optimum dose for the patient requirement, titrating initially about 6 to 8 weeks, then 3 months, and then once the patient is stimulated under some doses, 6 months is quite adequate. And again, while titrating the patient, TSH and FT4 is maximum testing. No need to do anything. Sometimes we can do with the TSH also. And maintenance dose we have already talked about. I think that's all I have to talk about. Thank you very much.
It's important to recognize because all of those cases may not need to be treated because once the basic primary pathology has been resolved, they should resolve them. Also, as sir has pointed out, clinically speaking, for all of us clinicians, anybody who's been having maybe a syndrome of atrial fibrillation, fluctuation of higher blood pressure, palpitations, etc., we know it could be a case of hypothyroidism, so one needs to screen adequately and responsibly. Also, all cases of pleural effusion or ascites or pericardial effusion will not be tubercular, so that is one has to keep at the back of the mind. In fact, in the NHS for people who are in remote areas, etc., since the thyroid hormone is a very long acting hormone, they tend to give, mind you, a once weekly dosage, it's not important otherwise. Secondly, I would like to make a mention, attending a conference of the Endocrine Society where they made it very clear, it need not be given empty stomach every time, it can be given after food also. So that's important, right? So that's there. Secondly, since I've been put up here in the chair with by Dr. John, so I get the privilege of asking the first two questions. Sir has elaborated very well about subclinical hypothyroidism. I just wanted to ask him, number one, whether the cardiometabolic risk profile and other associated problems, they remain the same as with overt hypothyroidism vis-a-vis subclinical hypothyroidism, number one. Secondly, as sir mentioned, there is a 10% incidence of type 1 diabetes with people of subclinical hypothyroidism. So, what are the basic figures or likelihood for type 2 diabetics? And after that, I'll just come over. Sir.
First question. The first one, when you said the cardiovascular outcome, when you treat the subclinical hypothyroidism in the cardiovascular patient, there is nothing said that the morbidity or mortality improves. The thyroid hormone doesn't confirm that they will be improving in the cardiac mortality outcome, but nonetheless, it improves their quality of life if it is required. So it is to be given with the care and precaution, but it's useful, but it doesn't confirm that if you give heat up to the cardiac patient or the prone power cardiac patient, that doesn't improve the cardiac life. Then coming to the second question, if you said cardiac. Type 1 diabetes being an autoimmune disorder, there is a high incidence, 10% reported here, I don't know the exact number, but it is just seen as I know. type 1 diabetes and hypothyroidism, very common. Even type 2 diabetes. There are large number of patients with diabetes. See that there are diabetic hypothyroid. I don't know the exact percentage, right, but there is also a commonly seen with the normal.
Thyroid problems, as we know, has a huge overlap, as sir mentioned, with you were mentioning congenital hypothyroidism. So I would invite a comment and thing from Dr. S.K. Sagal, who was my boss in Sadhujam, and gave me a torrid time. If there's anything that you would like to make. Dr. Sunil Sagal, and any other pediatrician who might be here, I'm sorry, I'm not informed. Sir.
I just wanted to know that.
Sir, you comment first, then you can ask a question.
Yeah,
I just wanted to say my
for child with congenital hypothyroidism. We usually use TSH. And what are the cutout levels, you know, because there is a lot of controversy on that, you know, as to whether it is 10 or 15 or 20, you know, when can we safe say that this is a safe level, you know, to say that the child, because it's mandatory nowadays. All kids are screened for thyroid because it's a treatable condition. So what is your take on the levels actually? You know, because there's a little bit of controversy on that.
TSH, second to
50,
you do not a TSH, serum TSH. It's not the heat reason. If it is less than 40, you rule out the adrenal time. And if it is more than 40, start eating. That is the first thing you said. Thereafter, after 3 to 4 weeks, 1 month is the window they want to give it. And in 1 month, we may do one or two more tests. If your clinical suspicion is very high, child clinical profile as we talk about, if you suspect the child is not growing, not developing, any different delay, or whatever the sucking difference the mother says, or there are facial expression like mixedemus facial expression swelling around there, then we can repeat TSH after that. I think the cutoff after 3 weeks is 10. If less than 10, we don't treat. More than 10, we
treat. So usually you say this 2 to 5 days.
But 2 to 5 days, yeah.
Many a time, you know, they take cord blood. And they give the report to most of the kids I see.
Yeah.
They do cord blood. So less what levels do you take for cord blood?
Less than 40. But we repeat after 2 weeks, 3 weeks, depending on the effect. Ultimately, 1 month is the window they want before that, less than 10. If it's more than 10, we should see.
Thank you, sir. Also, thyroid problems have a huge overlap with the surgeon counterparts. I can see Dr. Poddar and Dr. Mascara out here. So, any comments or any suggestion before I hand over the mic to Dr. Gulsi? Or they would like to refer the patients to Dr. Gulsi?
Undergo laparoscopic cholecystectomy after GA after 3-4 days. Would you like to treat
more? Go ahead.
TSH
9. Go ahead.
So many
surgeries.
So in case you have an emergency, if you have to open, you open.
No, it's not emergency.
Exactly. So then you wait for the things to stabilize. For example, if in a diabetic, if a patient is having an A1C 12%, and if he lands up with a surgical emergency, he has to be operated. Because even if you are reducing the sugar from, for example, 350 to 100-150, as what some of the surgeons want, it does not, repeat, does not change the prognostication. So you go ahead and operate, and you wait for other things to follow through, taking full care of asepsis, etc. Dr. Parashar sir, then
important. So if you have seen nodularity on the ultrasound, and it is multinodular goiter, then it is imperative that you keep the TSH level less than 2. By giving a toxin, so that the nodules which are small today may not become big and may require surgery in future. So if you want to avoid future surgery, you have to keep the TSH levels less than 2.
I mean,
thyroid nodules is adenoma, which are less than 2 centimeters.
Yes, sir.
When you see a gland palpable at a clinical examination, then ultrasound will become a more informative than a diagnostic. So when you see a gland palpable or visible by ultrasound,
treating again becomes a criteria.
Normal person does not get ultrasound done. There is a problem, you will get it done.
We don't require also normally ultrasound unless it is essential. Anyway, a good pipe to be taken, we should keep the teaser 2.5.
Dr. Mathu, just like pregnancy.
Sir, adding to Dr. Kota's point, I work in a surgical center. So sometimes you get patients with subclinical thyroidism, it takes as high as 24, and the status daily refuses to do the surgery unless you bring it down. So the surgery is not an emergency one. We can postpone the surgery, but suppose it's a patient with renal calculi, and the calculi has a high probability of going on to the ureter and obstructing. Sir, do we treat that TSS aggressively or do we do a wait and watch approach?
It's not going to make a difference.
It can differ for say at least 2 weeks. When you start treatment, 1 week is a window required to affect the medication. So it can be deferred for 2 weeks, start medication and wait for 1 week or 10 days, do a TSS again and see it is coming down, you can do something. Never overtreat the
emergency, you operate.
If the TSH is very high and if the FT4 is probably normal, probably the
patient will say
that.
Yeah, yeah. Right, like in subclinical hypothyroidism, we presume FT3, FT4 are normal.
Yeah.
So when they are normal, they are taking care of the metabolic state. The TSH is a pro-hormone which is subject to the negative feedback from the FT4.
Yeah.
So the clinically patient will tolerate. But on the safer side, if we have a time to delay for 2 weeks, delay it into it. That's what the point. If you are urgency, any TSH is there, you can do it.
Dr. Tulsi.
Very masterly talk. So the updated guidelines 2017 aren't much different.
Yeah.
They said no need to do T3, T4 routinely.
Yeah.
Just if your TSH is high, just measure free T4 or the free thyroxin index.
Yeah.
Routine examination of T3 is not recommended.
Definitely.
And they said that the referral ranges for patients above 65 years are higher. So be careful about that. They also talked about dilutional hyponatremia, which is very important with hyperlipidemia. So if you have a dilutional hyponatremia, look out for thyroid or hypothyroid. Sir, what about the anti-TPO antibodies? So it may disappear. That doesn't mean that you don't have Hashimoto's thyroiditis. See, it may disappear in the course of time.
True.
So it may be again that. And what about the iatrogenic thyroiditis or hypothyroidism? We are using amiodarone a lot these days, so that may be one of the reasons for that. Yeah. What else, sir? What about the?
What is the question?
Now is the question. Sir, what about mixed edema coma? You see, are you seeing these patients?
No, sir. I have comorbid condition. Anything happening around it, it's required from the ICU care. Where everything has to be treated besides the thyroid. You have to drive north. There is a concept of treating with a T3 and T4. That T3 has to be given in, I think, 4:1 ratio. T3, T4.
You use IV in those cases.
IV, of course, IV. And the bonus IV is given T4 and then T3 followed, and then T4 is given 2 months.
Thyroxine levels, thyroxine dose is higher. Look out for H. pylori, chronic gastritis, celiac disease.
And non-compliance.
Yeah, very rightly said that if we give it a look, as Dr. Kala rightly said, non-compliance. This is a very common thing we have. We, if there is a tropical stew, celiac disease, where the digestion is poor, the blood is passing out. And lastly, sir, in the doses profile, the TSS value has to be. Many a time the TSS values are not correct, and then we depend on that. So I would like to say in one comment, patient is to be treated on a merit, not only the medical. Just the laboratory test is not the only thing to treat. They are guiding to us. Deciding is not the same.
Generally, complaint of leg cramps, body aches, general debility, should we recommend them to have on vitamin E, vitamin D, or pizza, or COQ4, or you can recommend that?
Personally, you brought out the symptom complex of patients are very weak. The muscle cramps are not very uncommon find. Muscular pain may be a presenting feature for hypothyroid. Many patients come with only pain and no symptoms, no other signs of fact. And peace is there. So these patients can be treated along with the thyroid hormone treatment concomitantly, as you said, some vitamins, some supplements like vitamin D3, B12, they might help. The drug called B12 do help with the muscle cramps. I mean, they are subject to various individual experiences worldwide. But treatment of these patients requires a multi-measure approach, besides correcting the hypothyroidism. Then I like to say one more point I want to add. After all, what we are treating is hypothyroidism from a hormone which is produced outside the body. It is a T4 produced in the laboratory and given to the patient. It can't be as good what would have been produced in the body. There is always a lag between what we are giving and what patient would have been taking from the normal. So what is the role of thyroid hormone? It's to maintain our metabolism through utilizing oxygen. So first and foremost, talk to the thyroid patient if you can bring him to regular exercise. Lifestyle modification, exercises play a very vital role in the improvement of the thyroid. The dose is very important. Again, one more thing, Dr. Sulti, to share with you. Low TSS, I mean high TSS, is also to be considered a metabolic syndrome, a part of metabolic syndrome.
The patient once the TSH comes to normal, even then they complain.
The symptoms will remain, but that means the patient has been given a replacement from the outside, the body cannot perfect. It has 80-85% improvement. So you must motivate your patient to do the exercise and all metabolic disorders. Why I brought the metabolic syndrome? Is a metabolic syndrome means the conditions which are required, like diabetes, hypertension. In the hypothyroidism, you see a diastolic hypertension. So these are various things which you observe. To treat them along with the medicine and Dr. Kala, sir.
Question also. So you got to probe that point A. Do not give vitamin D too much blindly. Measure the levels. Because hypervitaminosis D is a very major problem, especially with respect to orthopedics giving, injectables, etc. Thirdly, coenzyme, what you mentioned, the dosage becomes 300 to 500 milligrams 3 times a day. Which
three
becomes,
times a day?
Yes. It is not only expensive, beyond a point, it is not of much use. So it is not recommended by the CSI or the RSDF. But most of these patients are having depression, so please probe that and treat that. I'm telling you, they would improve.
Sir, if you don't mind.
Sir, I wanted to know, you are the best person to guide. There are some dilemma and confusion about the diet in hypothyroidism. Some of my dietitians and nutritionists have some misconceptions. They are saying no soya, no coffee, no gluten, no fiber, or less fiber. What is your take on?
The little talk which I had and I spoke to him, that is a restriction in the hypothyroid patient. He said that there is no evidence-based practice. It is proved that any dietary restriction will improve or deteriorate thyroid health. So there is nothing to be talked about dietary. The patient liking and disliking is to be respected. Whatever he or she wants to eat, give them to eat freely. And there is no adverse or better that is what we done.
Only agreed, sir. Sir, I want to know whether the negative feedback happens more at the level of TSS or TRH?
TSS. Actually, but TRS also has an influence because the feedback goes to the hypothyroidism also.
When we say family history, so when we start say one generation back, then there was iodine deficiency rampant and now iodine deficiency is hardly there. So is it still related to genetics or environmental?
Sir, what Dr. Sengupta just said, ki thyroid disorder of autoimmune nature. It is genetically predisposed. Iodine deficiency is not genetic. It is a deficiency of the environmental nature. Where today, as you rightly said, ki there are iodine sufficient, which may be the cause of autoimmune thyroid disorder. As it is said in discussion.
Sir, does birth weight also matter when we decide whether a person is having hypothyroid? As we have in diabetes, lot of overweight is there. So, do the patients who are hypothyroid by birth or congenital, when we are seeing cord blood and all, sir, does it matter the birth weight also?
Birth weight is more related to the diabetes, But sir, weight, just take a point from you here, weight and hypothyroidism. There is a misnomer in society because I have become overweight because of hypothyroidism. Hypothyroidism, when you develop, there will be 2 or 3 kg weight, not much. And it gets corrected once you get to hypothyroidism. Weight is basically a genetic or inherited to the person. Somebody has a tendency to gain weight, whether he eats A or B or whatever it is. If he doesn't do regular exercise, doesn't control his diet properly, the weight will go. So thyroid per se is not the real cause of weight. Am I right?
I wanted to understand that cold blood levels and after 2-3 days or 1 week, how does it
more
take?
Light I would recommend Dr. to give it. Cold blood has got an importance in the guiding practice, they do it. And they say it is less than 40 B, rule out the direct hypothyroidism. Another guideline is 2-5 days they do it. And then after there are this up to 3-4 weeks. Yeah. There's a thing.
Half
question, sir.
I happened to go to a camp day for yesterday. And there, you know, a lot of people came with TSH in the range of about 6, 7, 5, ladies and gents. You know, in such patients, should we start a thyroid treatment or
no?
Correct.
For 4 very not uncommon. Now, this is the condition where we have not seen the T4, FT4. Probably that will be normal. So, condition is subclinical hypothyroidism. Now, the guideline would be to have subclinical hypothyroidism. Clinical examination, antibodies, if they both fit into the area. Otherwise, re-urine test. One more thing, that second test should be important. One test is not sufficient to treat thyroid. There is long-term treatment. If you start treatment, you don't know where to stop. So, confirm the diagnosis by repeating test. Maybe change the lab or whatever it is. It should be done.
Dr. Tulsi mentioned about hyponatremia. I just quote one patient who walks into the hospital and is admitted for some purpose, for some surgery, and the sodium levels come 109. He walks conscious. And the the ICU doctor, who's a very enthusiast, shifts to the ICU and starts correcting. And in a span of 2 days, this patient becomes unconscious. And he'll put a rise to catheter, this and that, and you're prognosticating very bad. The TSH came 63. We know that hyponatremia is the hypothyroidism is the most important cause. And the MRI scan showed hyperintensity in the pons. So the patient had developed CPM. So how important it is to diagnose hypothyroidism? This patient just required.
Very good. So the TSH, there is no effect of the food on the thyroid levels. It can be taken any time of the day. And secondly, the time frame, it is a circadian pattern. It's lower in the early hour of the morning. It goes up. So there is a value which is given, why they are given a normal value from 0.5 to 4.5. That is for the diurnal variation of the TSH. It can be taken any time of the day. There is no time frame for TSH. And the food or anything doesn't affect that thing.
And secondly, as Dr. Sanjukta said, that it can be taken after weekly also.
She is the worse half, he is the better half.